Hello there, I'm Reverend Yan, founder of Evolving Enneagram. If you've been seeking a compassion-based, contemplative approach to Enneagram inner work, you are certainly in the right place. We are in the midst of a 52-week Sunday talk series based on the book by Orin J. Sofer, Your Heart Was Made for This. And we're in our 32nd week, and our topic today is joy. My theme for today is the vulnerability of joy. So I want to explore, again, we're taking this from a contemplative perspective, a perspective in which it's not like the ego chasing down joy or hustling for joy, but how do we cultivate a fertile soil in consciousness that allows joy almost as a soulful quality to arise naturally within us, a space that does not reject our other emotions, including sorrow and other emotions that are more challenging, right? That one that isn't about a spiritual bypass or toxic positivity, but rather opens to authentic joy that is fostered by our own vulnerability and our letting go. So with that, let's begin. So I want to begin with a passage by Father Richard Rohr in his daily emails. He sends these contemplative emails out. This one is all the way back, was sent in 2021 on the topic of crisis contemplation and joy. And I'm just going to read the very beginning, one little paragraph. In my Franciscan tradition, he writes, joy comes from an inner realization of true experiential union with God, or reality, consciousness, and life itself. This realization descends upon us at ever deeper levels as we walk our faith journey. Authentic joy, however, takes place through our pain, not under it, to the right, left, or over it. There is much covering up, escaping or denying our suffering in unhealthy religion. God calls us instead to the whole Paschal mystery, passion, death, and resurrection. Yeah. So this is the kind of joy I'm talking about that contains our fullness and our wholeness, the experience of the depth of our humanity. Notably, Brené Brown, famous vulnerability researcher and the author of the recent Atlas of the Heart. The long name for that is Mapping Meaningful Connection and the Language of Human Experience. So she's actually addressing in her research and her book, like the spectrum of human emotions. She refers to joy as the good mood of the soul, right? And so she continues, there is definitely something soulful about joy. Based on our research, she says, I define joy as an intense feeling of deep spiritual connection, pleasure, and appreciation. So I'd like to take a moment here for you to pause, if you're able to do so, pause the recording and just kind of check in with yourself about that, like what moments you have experienced joy in your life, right? And what that feels like, what that has felt like, what were the conditions around it? I don't know about you, but it wasn't like necessarily for me in moments when I accomplished something I wanted to accomplish. It was often in some unexpected moment, like on a hike, the light coming through the window, all my loved ones, you know, in a room together, and in the quietude of that moment, this burst of joy, just like arising. Right. So actually, that might be a good time to share this. I want to share a moment of that pure, inexplicable joy with you. I woke up one morning and wrote this poem. And so again, I just want to share this to share a bit about my own personal journey with joy and invite you to consider how this might relate to your own. This poem happened to be published in We Moon, 2023 calendar. That's Gaia Rhythms for Women, We Moon calendar. This joy in nothing. Sometimes you wake up with this inexplicable joy, with your gut curled up into a Cheshire smile, and your left shoulder pulls back into a wink that no one else can see. And you look around for the source of this smug delight, but can't, at a glance, find its origin in any particular thing. Not in the whisper of a morning that gently beckoned you awake just in time, before anyone else would even think of rising at this Mad Hatter coffee over tea hour, before the light of the sun has even risen, so you know that not even beauty is to blame. Not for this. This is the best joy. This is the first joy. This is the last joy. This joy in nothing. So, this is what I want to invite you to consider for this week, that there are ways in which we chase after, quest for something outside ourselves to bring us joy. And in that, we become less available to the soul joy that rises spontaneously in ways that are inexplicable, right? For no apparent reason, not even beauty is to blame for this joy in nothing. And as I invite you to consider this, I want to name why Brené Brown refers to this as a place of vulnerability. Well, she says that true joy, she says that if you're afraid, this is her words, if you're afraid to lean into good news, wonderful moments, and joy, if you find yourself waiting for the other shoe to drop, you are not alone. It's called foreboding joy, and most of us experience it. She says, foreboding joy is one of those practically universal experiences that everyone thinks of as something only they do. But a few people don't experience it. Most of us do, she says. And actually, when it comes to parents, 95% of the parents they interviewed experience foreboding joy with their children. And in that, so the idea is that she teaches, when we lose our tolerance for vulnerability, joy becomes foreboding. And no emotion is more frightening than joy, because if we allow ourselves to feel joy, we are inviting disaster, is the belief, right? We start dress rehearsing tragedy in the best moments of our lives in order to stop vulnerability from beating us to the punch. So we're terrified, she says, of being blindsided by pain. So we practice tragedy and trauma, but there's a huge cost. Notably, in their research, Brené Brown found that everyone who showed a deep capacity for joy had one thing in common, that in the midst of joy, there's this shudder of vulnerability. And rather than using that as a warning sign to practice imagining worst case scenarios, the people who lean into joy use that quiver as a reminder to practice gratitude. So the practice of gratitude can help us to feel into that receiving, right? So gratitude, I think of gratitude often as it's a receiving feeling, right? And receiving is very vulnerable for many of us. So with that, I want to invite you to consider again, yes, ultimately we cultivate spaces for joy to arise irrespective of the outer conditions, right? But there's also the piece of how when joy does arise, we don't squash that little quiver, right, by shifting into that sense of foreboding joy that we are inclined to do because of that sense of vulnerability in really receiving the moment as it is, and not then trying to control the next moment by trying to find ways to ensure that this moment of joy will stay here forever, right? So yeah, that we can't not only catch it, but we can't clasp it, right? So with that, I'd like to bring forth some reflections regarding the Enneagram now. So for type ones, I want you to consider that feelings of guilt and shame can arise when you have joy come up inside of you, because there is this belief that for goodness and order to exist in the world, you have to be constantly suffering or efforting, right? And so this feeling of joy can bring up a sense of overindulgence or selfishness in you, and that brings up the guilt. And so just be aware of that, how those negative feelings can come in to censor your joy. And it's okay to let those other feelings be there, but see if you can hold space for all of them together and just breathe with all of them together. And for twos are so comfortable with the idea that you're bringing joy to somebody else, right? And so consider allowing yourself to have joy in solitude, perhaps through a creative pursuit or a walk in the woods, joy that is wholly unrelated to meeting someone else's needs or desires. You know I'm talking to you. You know who you are. So three, you can tend to replace a sense of accomplishment with spontaneous joy that arises from simply being in and receiving the moment. So threes, it's important to open to the notion that expansive and authentic joy is unearned, right? Fours, joy can feel superficial or fake in contrast to suffering, but joy is actually the other side of the coin of your wholeness and thus your authenticity. And so when you reject that, you actually reject your authentic self. It's important to note that. And notice how your disdain of joy can be a way you stay fixated in this ego identity of suffering, which is not your true self. So for fives, notice how you tend to damp down joy because of your fear of having desires. Wanting or needing can just bring up fears, whether it's a fear of being depleted or fear of being rejected. So remember, joy is an inner resource. And so allowing it actually nourishes and resources you, so you're less depleted. But it brings up that little, oh my gosh, you know, because I don't have any desires. That's the storyline of many fives, but you do. And so making space for that is so vital and healing and nourishing. So sixes, foreboding joy. I mean, you could have described the six in that foreboding joy description, right? Foreboding joy, though, is future focused. And so notice how the fear that the rug will be pulled out from under you, that fear operates preemptively in sixes. So the fear, with your fear, you've already pulled out the rug, right? At least you got some control because you pulled out the rug. Now you're not enjoying in joy of what you have in the moment because you've pulled out the rug just to keep someone else from doing it in a way that feels less secure or controlled, right? So you take away your own joy that way. Seven. The question for you is, what happens when you stop chasing after joy and feel into the anxiety of staying in the moment, in the present, and being all in? So, all in, you know, partly in, partly out. That's great for sevens, but like all in. And that way, joy can arise as a gift. And for eights, just again, remembering that difference between asserting and receiving. And so eights, joy is received. Joy is received rather than created or demanded, right? And so sit back, drop down, drop into your heart. Joy is a gift of patience and stillness. So finally, nines. Joy arises when you let yourself care about and engage with the moment rather than tune it out. So joy can disrupt the sense of inner monotony, and that can be scary, right? It's like you say you want joy, but not really, because that's actually can feel destabilizing to that sort of inner numbness that you have. So part of you traded in energizing, inspiring joy in favor of a state of inner calm, which is a muted way of being, a numbed out, sleepy way of being. And so just recognize when you realize, oh, you know, joy, it's like disruptive. It can feel disruptive. And that's not always easy for nines to make space for. So with that, I think that's enough for this week. I have more to say, but we will continue with joy next week. And whatever you glean from this talk, I just want to invite you to remember the purpose of it is to invite space for joy, not to make this another should. Okay. So really it's about just going, hey, you know what? Yeah. Through looking at my Enneagram lens, I can see where I quash it and where I actually already have access to more joy than I realized, that I don't even have to go looking for more, that it's here, that it's available. And there's something little that happens inside, sometimes big, that happens inside each of us, where our type protects us from that vulnerability. So here's to an authentically joy-filled week. See you next week.